I now request Mr. Subbu from BIM 36th batch, representing the student council, to come and take the proceedings for the validatory function. Thank you, everyone.
Hi, good evening all once again. It's a matter of great privilege to be here before this august gathering today, and I take this opportunity to thank all the speakers who graced us today with their presence and the participants for being with us this long throughout the event, of course, virtually. The key takeaways from all the sessions we had today was so impactful and crucial and highly informative to budding business graduates like us, and it gave us amazing insights, paving way for our career in corporate world. As the main theme shed light upon the contemporary disruptions we as a global community are facing right now, it was a delight to hear a myriad of valuable thoughts on various impactful topics from disruptive innovation, human capital, data and decisions, and about entrepreneurships and startups. It was an erudite session, and it was an enriching experience to hear from such eminent speakers, and I'm sure it was a tremendous value addition to all of you as well. Every successful story ends with a spectacular ending, and to have such power-packed climax to Athenaeum, I invite the guest of honor, Mr. Rohit Pathak, President and CEO of Aditya Birla Insulators and Aditya Birla Power Composites. And I am Ahmedabad alumni. Mr. Rohit started his career as a design engineer at Analog Devices and went on to become the associate in McKinsey & Company for a period of 2001 to 2011. Then he moved on to work as principal EA to Aditya Birla Group's chairman, Mr. Kumara Mangalam Birla, helping manage all the businesses of around $40+ billion of Aditya Birla Group. 2016 onwards, he was appointed as the president and CEO of Aditya Birla Insulators, one of the largest insulator players in India and third largest porcelain player globally. Currently, Mr. Rohit is serving as the first CEO of Aditya Birla Power Composite Limited in 2019. He is also one of the board members of ABPCL. It is a moment of great pride to have a man of his stature amongst us, and I welcome Mr. Rohit Pathak to address the gathering. Over to you, sir.
Namaskar, and thank you for the warm welcome and the honor to address you as part of Athenaeum 2020, the annual research conference of SECMAR, the research wing of Bharatidasan Institute of Management. I think as the world economic order witnesses a major transition, the theme for your annual conference, globalization versus glocalization in the age of disruption, is very apt. And I believe the four sub-themes you deliberated on, disruptive innovation, data and decisions, managing human capital, and entrepreneurship and startups, are very apt elements for this shift that we are witnessing in the global economic order. Given you've already deliberated on most of these key aspects at length through the day, let me use this time to put forth amongst you a different perspective on what opportunity this presents to us as a nation, for Indian companies, and for you as the new leadership of the nation. The industry we are witnessing, we are already witnessing a major disruption as the digital age transforms economies and the workplace at a pace most traditional players are struggling to cope with, leaving behind a graveyard of failed businesses, large and small, that are not able to survive this rapid onslaught. However, this transition is coming at a time when most large economies have started to look inwards after decades of globalization. Whether it was Trump's campaign of making America great again, or UK's exit from EU, or India's Make in India initiative, or Japan's incentive to companies to move back manufacturing from China to Japan. Almost all the leading economies of the world, as well as the smaller ones, have started to think local first in recent years. But before we delve into this shift towards globalization, let us understand the spirit behind globalization and why did it start to fail nations? While trade in commodities, whether it was oil, coal, metals, grains, gems, and textiles, has always been prevalent, over the past 3 to 4 decades, globalization took trade from commodities to manufactured goods and services and became the theme for most companies based on 3 fundamental tenets. First, produce where the manufacturing cost is lowest. Second, create scale to further reduce cost and build barriers. And third, treat the entire world as the market and create demand for your products world over. It was primarily a push model for products and services, especially from the developed world to the underdeveloped or developing countries. Japan, followed by Korea, and now China, have leveraged the globalization wave over the past 3 to 4 decades to become the manufacturing hubs of the world. However, this wave seems to have reached the limit of creating value, and globalization has begun to fall apart, primarily because of 3 reasons. One, there has been a rapid and large-scale job loss in developed as well as developing countries, with cheaper in imports, especially of manufactured goods. Local industries in most countries took a big hit, and the workforce could not be retained or refocused to other areas fast enough. Second, the large disparity amongst nations and also amongst populations. Large trade deficits have resulted in many countries falling into debt and forex traps and economic turmoil. The MSMEs, the medium and small scale industries in most countries that employ the largest workforce have continued to struggle for relevance in the game of scale. And the third reason is that new problems and challenges have been created at a pace faster than countries could solve them. For example, handling pollution and waste, managing the rapid urbanization as countries catapulted from agrarian societies to service economies without having a strong manufacturing base, health crisis with junk and alien food being introduced faster than the human body could adapt. With scale, resource consumption has also increased with move towards the what I call the use and throw culture driven by the push sales. The conflicting forces of globalization and nationalism are making governments and companies rethink their priorities and are focusing them to come up with new constructs. In a post-globalized world, communities and people find themselves on either side of an increasingly stark divide between winners and losers. Against this backdrop of multiple competing interests is the one unifying truth, which is that we all share this planet and will collectively drive it to its rescue or doom. In 2019, the sustainability agenda came to fore like never before in a charge led by the Generation Z. What kind of a future are you creating for us, they asked, and nations and companies are being coaxed into finding the right answers. And it is in this context that I would like to share a radical perspective to this opportunity that we as a nation have been presented with in a rapidly evolving global context. One, where the world is getting wary of China, that had become the factory of the world, with almost 50% of the world manufacturing happening in that country, and people looking for more reliable and trustworthy partners. And this is an opportunity that we can, or rather should, seize, but not as India, but as Bharat, a nation that not only dominated the world global economy for over 2 millennia, that is 2,000 years, but was also the technological leader across fields and a spiritual guide for the world. And perhaps it is not just a coincidence that I table this thought at the Bharatidasan Institute, which has Bharat embedded in its name. But before I share with you my perspective on what we as a nation, as companies and leaders do, let me delve a little bit on Bharat as the global economic leader. As analyzed by the IMF, Bharat was over 30% of the global GDP since the start of the common era right until the 15th century. This, even after centuries of invasions and loot by the Turks, Afghans, and Mughals. Yes, for over 1500 years, we were twice the share of the global GDP compared to what the US is today. That is quite a lot for 1500 years. Even after the 15th century, Bharat remained a top two economy, second only to China, until the 18th century, when the British rule set in. And it was only these last two centuries under British rule that slowly, with systematic extraction of resources and wealth, we were reduced to lesser than 3% of global GDP by 1947. Over these two centuries, we slowly got conditioned to become a market for British ideas and products, and a supplier of talent and resources for them. However, what was probably sad is that even post-independence, we continue to operate with that same mindset. Yes, perhaps British has got replaced with a broader notion of the West, but we still remain a market for Western ideas and products and a supplier of talent and resources to them. And despite getting into the top six economies, we are still just 3% of the global GDP. We remain in awe of global companies and products, prefer using either cheaper Chinese imports or overpriced Western products, many of which are, by the way, not tailored for our use. And the US dream is still perhaps the biggest draw on most good educational campuses. This is because during this last leg of foreign rule, we lost our pride as a nation of our ability and worth. And post-independence, we have not done much to rekindle that pride in our youth. And by this statement, I don't mean that we do not look to the West or do not learn from the West or the developed worlds of what they have got right. But I want to ensure that we focus on what we are good at and build on that in parallel. If you really research, most of the scientific laws of fact that we learn today, whether it's Newton's or Einstein's laws or Darwin's theories, had all been written about in depth in the ancient texts of Bharat. But we lost the key to this knowledge, Sanskrit. Isn't it ironic that the language which is the key to the largest bank of scientific knowledge even today, and one that NASA or Germany are still pursuing avidly to discover the truths and technical secrets which they still don't know. In the home country of Sanskrit, the language is restricted at best to a three-year crash course that some of us did in a secondary school. Do you think China, and before them Japan or Korea, got to where they were by merely copying the West? Even as they look to break into these Western markets, they continue to bank on their own manufacturing for their local consumption and continue to work on the quality until they perfected and even surpassed the Americans and Europeans. They also invested heavily into taking bold positions in the technologies of the future. While today we are all talking of electric vehicles, I remember as far back as in 2004-05, when I was at McKinsey, I used to travel often to China. And even then, it was a stated goal in China that while they lost out on the internal combustion engine technology of automotive and will probably play a catch-up to the West, on electric vehicles, they will lead the world. And they have done that. Today, they are the largest EV manufacturers, and the latest technologies are coming from them. Yes, Tesla is perhaps one of those companies which has done better. But as an industry, the Chinese EV industry is perhaps the one that is dominating the world in supply chain as well as in scale. Same has been done with digital and technology. Chinese funds and companies are the largest acquirers of startups world over in these areas. So why do I believe that this mindset shift from India to Bharat is important for us if we are to regain our rightful place in the global order? Well, I feel there are three specific reasons why this shift in our mindset is important. First, I think we need to adopt a leader and innovator mindset instead of a follower, adopter mindset. If you go back a millennia, you will find that Bharat was the pioneer not just in textiles and agri products, but also in metallurgy, healthcare, education, astronomy, architecture, agriculture practices. And the advances in each of these domains were unparalleled and unsustainable. I remember I recently went to the Madhura State Sun Temple that was built 1,000 years ago. Do you know that it was so perfectly designed and built that only on the equinox days, the rays of the sun would fall directly on the diamond on the crown of the sun god and light up the entire temple. Such was the knowledge of astronomy and the precision of architecture and geometry. And remember, that was an era when most of the world still believed the earth was flat. However, over the years, we have lost this knowledge with systematic and brutal destruction of our education systems and texts. When Bhaktiyar Khilji burnt Nalanda University, the library there burnt for over 3 months. Such was the extent of knowledge. Yes, we need to understand and bring the best of the world to India, but we also need to take the best of Bharat to the world. And for this, we need to be proud of what we are and what we can do. Second, we need to solve for our challenges in our unique ways and sustainable ways. We are a large population and we cannot just copy Western solutions for our problems, sometimes even perceived problems. We need to identify our unique problems and then develop our own solutions for these. And then with the scale in India, take these solutions to the world. A classic example is the e-commerce space. We have a vibrant and widespread retail network. So instead of adopting the standard West e-commerce model, we needed to build on our small retail network to create the right blend of omni-channel that ensures the small retailer also thrives as you bring inefficiencies of large-scale e-commerce. However, as you probably know, most e-com players started with a cut, copy, paste of the Western models. And only now some of them are moving to leverage the small retail and local kirana. As we adopt new technology, we need to keep in mind that many of these have been developed in the backdrop of nations with low population densities, looking to solve for different challenges of low manpower availability. In India, our challenges are different. We always need to keep an eye on ensuring we are creating sufficient jobs to keep our large population engaged. Else, we will land straight into social unrest. Our objectives as a nation cannot be the same as that of US or Germany. And our companies need to first identify and then solve for our challenges. The third point is, we need to bring back ecosystems that are in sync with nature and society. In today's language, sustainable. While in the Western managerial thought, traditionally thinking has been very linear in how you do things. Whether it's an annual budgeting exercise, I've done this now for the last 20 years and seen different companies, all of us end up focusing on only linear budgeting, right? What did you do last year? What is the growth you planned this year? And that's what governs everything. When we look at GDP, the same story, right? Last year versus this year is all that counts. The Bharatiya systems generally used to follow a very closed principle. And while, yes, the scale of industry and also the population today cannot be compared with what we had a millennia ago, the concepts and the thought process are still very valid. Let me illustrate this through an example. One of my McKinsey colleagues who turned historian recently shared about the temples of Chola Empire and how they operated. When a rich person would come to donate to the temple and ask for a diya to be lit in memory of their loved one, temple priests would ask them to instead donate cows or goats to a poor family around the temple with the same money instead. The poor family would then give ghee for the diya for perpetuity, and the extra earnings from the milk would help spread prosperity in the neighborhood. A simple idea, but sustainable, and not just as an economic system, but also as a social system. As the tension between nationalism and globalization reshapes the world, this will perhaps be the most defining trend as we head into a new decade. Today, we see a very different world from what we saw at the start of this millennia in 2000. Dealing with the consequences of globalization and its discontent. a world where rules of commerce are being rewritten all around, a world where nationalism has surpassed globalization as the more popular search term on Google. And hence, companies need to also adopt a different approach to their strategies. For example, this new trend raises questions that challenge conventional wisdom on how businesses should distribute their capacities as trade becomes more regional. The traditional benefits of a single location operation are an obvious contrast to the resilience that multiple locations, local operations provide. So there may be no easy answers, but the reality of this new world is something we need to be very alive to. While scale will remain key, even in the coming decade, the manner in which companies build and leverage scale shall change dramatically. It is not just about scale of manufacturing, but scale of brand. Look at Airbnb, or scale of consumer insights or customer insights. Look at Google, Facebook, and of talent. Companies like Birla's and Tata's have leveraged this well to keep growing and expanding what they do. And these all elements of scale will be probably more important than just manufacturing scale. Second, sustainability, and not just environmental, but also societal and business model sustainability, will need to be a core element of business thinking. And finally, digital and artificial intelligence will need to be weaved into every part of the operation, internal and external. I remember recently listening to Dr. Ram Charan, who is one of the leading management thinkers globally. And his one point suggestion to all of us at the Aditya Birla Group was, you need to create multiple teams for different areas, which are cross-functional in nature, and ensure that in every team, there is one person who understands data and analytics. Without that, you will not be able to capture any opportunity going forward. So as corporations navigate this uncertain shift, the leadership in the coming decade, which is you, I believe will need to adopt a very different mindset. So let me share with you my thoughts on what will it take to craft the next gen workplace. So, I've used CRAFT as an acronym, and let me explain to you what this means in my perspective. First, courage. Business models are changing fast. You will need to have the courage to take tough calls of transforming, diversifying businesses before it is too late, and you will be forced to change. And typically, all the threat comes from outside your industry. Leaders will also need courage to take the right actions, keeping sustainability in mind and not get swayed by the pressure of the quarterly annual results. Even great companies like GE, as some of you might have read in recent months, have fallen because of this quarterly pressure on results, which pushed them to think short-term and not long-term sustainability of their business models. Right? So the first element of what you need to do, and as you craft the next gen workplace, is to ensure that you have courage in how you think and decide and drive your businesses. The second element is resilience. Be the last person standing. Challenges, adversities make you stronger. Industry cycles are becoming shorter and sharper, especially for individual sectors and business models. Building organizational as well as employees' resilience is going to be very important. In my own industry in insulators, we used to make porcelain insulators, which was 80-90% of the global market just about 20 years ago. Today, porcelain is less than 50% of the global market, and newer materials have taken root, which are probably cheaper and have served some of the customers better. And as a result, we've had to completely change our manufacturing and sales and marketing approach in the last 5 years to keep up pace with the rapidly changing global environment. And I think, ours is probably still a very slowly evolving industry. If I look at some of the retail or the FMC sectors or technology sectors, pace of change is very, very high. And unless companies have the resilience to go through one or two weak cycles, they will not be able to come out alive at the end of the cycle. The third element is agility in strategy and execution. So while you can be the last person standing in a downturn in the industry, can you also be the first person forward? Have directional strategy clear, but show agility as you spot opportunities and trends early. You need the right organization structure to be able to spot the trends and aggressively use partnerships instead of trying to do everything yourself. Especially as the digital world meets the physical world, unlikely handshakes is what will create disruptions. And most companies today are still very, very, I would say, wary of trying to create partnerships, right? But I think this is one very key element of any strategy for any company which is of any material scale in the coming years. You need to be able to create unlikely partnerships to create the next scale of growth for yourself. The fourth area is flatten the hierarchy. Agility and innovation will both require companies to reduce the number of levels and organize teams internally with, like I said, analytical and digital talent embedded within each team. Gone are the days where you had a very long, career path for people from trainee to, several levels of managers and general managers and vice presidents and presidents. I think, those 15-20 level hierarchies are history. And the faster we make that transition as companies, the better. And fifth element of the new gen workplace, in my view, is going to be trust. I think COVID time has taught all of us how important this element is. And this is not just the trust of the company on its talent, but also of the talent on the company and the leadership. This will be a big differentiator for talent retention in the new corporate environment. Earlier on, people would look at how long people are working. Remember, who leaves office at what time. Today, for the last 8-9 months, most of us have worked from home remotely. And you have no clue to find out what your team is doing. And people have begun to realize that, yes, probably the better way of managing teams is to look at output and not input or how many hours they work, but what they deliver in the time that they work, right? And hence that trust of you, of the leadership in the talent is very, very important in the coming years. So in conclusion, what I would urge you, the future leaders of our nation, is you should think about rekindling your pride in Bharat and reclaim our place in the global economic order that we held for over 85% of the last 2000 years since the Common Era started. Craft the charge to take Bharat to the world. While the Prime Minister has given the call for Atmanirbhar Bharat and Vocal for Local, each one of us as citizens of this nation and the companies and entrepreneurs here will determine whether we can truly reclaim the legacy of Bharat economically, technologically, and increasingly spiritually. Or will we continue to be mere markets for foreign ideas and products and remain mentally subservient to foreign interests? Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
A wonderful speech, and we have Bharat in Bharatidasan. So we, the students of Bharatidasan University, will definitely work towards the envision Bharat. We can go back to the roots, and definitely all your ideas and visions are doable. Thank you for the wonderful speech once again, sir. Now I call upon Professor Satya to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I am honored to present the vote of thanks for Athenaeum 2020. Someone said, feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and not giving it. With that note, I would like to take this opportunity to propose a word of thanks to all the people who have made Athenaeum 2020 a roaring success. I would like to start with thanking and expressing our deep sense of gratitude to Mr. Rohit Pathak, CEO of Aditya Birla Insulators, for graciously accepting our invitation to honor this occasion. I would also like to place on record Dr. Himanshu Roy's contribution and his gracious presence in accepting the invitation for being the chief guest for the inaugural ceremony in the morning. I would like to thank Professor Elizabeth Rose, Srinivas Dagam, Mr. Sumanta Ray, Dr. Bikramji Chowdhury, Ms. Matangi Shri, Mr. Manish Gupta, Mr. Tanveer Singh, Ms. Supriya Danda, and Ms. Ramya Balakrishnan, and the speakers of the panel four, Professor Satyajit Majumdar, Mr. Vaidishwara, and Mr. Govind, for accepting our invitation to be part of the panel discussions for various panels. I would like to thank all the participants from various B schools, faculty, researchers, and students from various B schools in our country who have had the patience to sit through the proceedings throughout the day. I'll take this opportunity to express our deep sense of gratitude to Sri T. Kannan, Chairman Board of Governors BIM Trichy, and other members of the Governor Board of Governors for their constant encouragement. We would like to thank Dr. John Peter, Director BIM Trichy, for his continuous support to the faculty, staff, and students and helping us get better at what we do. I would like to thank Dr. Jay Krishna, convener of Athenaeum 2020, for his guidance to all the students to organize Athenaeum 2020. I would like to acknowledge the contribution of Professor Ruma Agnes, my fellow coordinator for Athenaeum 2020, and other faculty members, Dr. V.P. Srinaman, Dr. S.N. Raghavendra, and Professor Sudarshan, for their constant support to all the students in organizing this event well. We would like to praise our appreciation to the alumni community of BIM Trichy, who have been a source of inspiration for the current batches, that is BIM 36 and 37, with their stupendous achievements after their tenure at BIM Trichy. We would like to express our appreciation to the Student Council for their efforts in organizing Athenaeum 2020. And we would like to thank all the student volunteers who have worked in different teams to make this event a great success. I would like to thank Mr. Charles Prem Singh from the Technology Department of BIM Trichy for his technology support and helping us navigate this virtual platform seamlessly throughout this day. I would also like to thank all the staff of BIM Trichy, Mr. Prabhakaran and others who have made significant contribution to make this event a success. I'd also like to thank the media personnel for their support, and I look forward to participation from each one of the audience and also the faculty, staff, and students of BIM Trichy, and look forward to your presence in the next edition of Athenaeum. With that, I call upon Subbu to take this forward. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now that we have come to the end of the conference, thank you all once again for being part of this and making Athenaeum 2020 a grand success. As a testimonial to the topics that we discussed today, disruptions, we definitely adapted to the present situation of the pandemic and made this virtual conference a grand success. It wouldn't be possible without the support of all the speakers and the participants and the team for organizing this. I thank you all once again, and thank you all for giving me this opportunity to be your MC for the day. Now I request all of you to stand from your respective places for the national anthem.
Jai Hind.
Thank you.